In our today's topic, we will cover the remaining part of the major productive system. And the objectives of our today's lecture will be to cover the spermatic cords, the different ducts, seminal vesicles, ejaculatory ducts, prostate gland, urethra, and penis. So starting with the spermatic cord, we have previously discussed about it you know that spermatic cord basically suspend the testes in the scrotum. And in this image you can see that the spermatic cord is carrying the testicular artery, the vas deferens, and there are the veins as well. And it also contains the nerves. If we talk about its anatomical cores, then the cord will be covered in a sheath of smooth muscle and connective tissue and fibrous tissue, and it extends to the inguinal canal, and then it attaches to the testes on the posterior wall. Here you can see its anatomical cores. You can see here that it is passing through the superficial inguinal ring, and then it is attaching it to the itself to the posterior wall of the testes. So once again, the spermatic cord, we refer the spermatic cord to a collection of vessels, nerves and ducts that run to and from the testes, and they are surrounded by the fascia that basically is forming a cord like structure. That's why we call them the spermatic cords. Then we talked about the anatomical cores of the spermatic cord, and we said that the spermatic cord begins inferior in the inferior abdominal wall, and it ends in the scrotum that we have discussed in our previous lecture. And now you know that the spermatic cord is formed at the opening of the inguinal canal. And then this cord will pass through the inguinal canal, entering into the scrotum via this superficial inguinal ring. And it will continue into the scrotum, and then it will end and it will attach itself to the posterior border of the testes. The spermatic cord has facial coverings as well. And the all coverings are basically derived from the interior abdominal wall. Here you can see the external spermatic fascia. In this image you can see the multiple layers, and the external spermatic fascia is basically derived from the deep subcutaneous fascia. Then you can see the cremaster muscle here, and this is basically derived from the internal oblique muscle and its facial coverings. And the last covering is the internal spermatic fascia. You don't have to remember the derivation of these fascia, but you should know about the names of these fascia, that there are basically three facial layers of the spermatic cord, and these all are derived from the interior abdominal wall, and these are the external spermatic fascia, the cremasteric muscle and fascia, and the internal spermatic fascia. And the cremaster muscle forms the middle layer of the spermatic cord fascia, and it is a discontinuous layer of the striated muscle that is oriented longitudinally, and you can see its shape, and you can guess from its shape that the muscles are striated and these are oriented longitudinally. If we talk about the contents of the spermatic cord, we have already discussed about the contents, but we will revise them once again. So we know that there will be a testicular artery that we know is the branch of the aorta, and there will be the vas deferens and pampiniform plexus. in this image. They have highlighted the pampiniform plexus. So this is basically a plexus of testicular veins, and this pampiniform plexus basically drains the venous blood from the testes into the testicular vein. Okay, so now we will move on to the vas deferens, and the vas deferens is basically 45 centimeter long, and you can see that it passes upwards from the testes through the inguinal canal, and it ascends medially towards the posterior wall of the bladder, where it is joined by the duct from the seminal vesicle to form the ejaculatory duct. This is the course of the vas deferens, and the length of the vas deferens, as you can see, is approximately 45 centimeter, and you can see its course, that it is passing upwards from the testes. These are the testes, and the vas deferens is passing upwards from the testes through the inguinal canal, and then it ascends more, and it will then travel medially towards the posterior abdominal wall. This is the interior part of the bladder, and this is the posterior part of the bladder. So it is going posteriorly to the posterior wall of the bladder, and then here it will join by the duct from the seminal vesicle. This is the seminal vesicle that is highlighted in blue, and you could see a duct coming from here as well, and this duct will join with the vas deferens, and then they both will join to form the ejaculatory duct. And this structure here that you can see is the prostate gland that we will discuss in our next slide. So once again, we will talk about the course, anatomical course of the vas deferens or the deferent duct. You can see that this is approximately 45 centimeter long, and its course is starting from the testes, and you can see that it is passing upwards from the testes through the inguinal canal, and then it is ascending more medially towards the posterior bladder wall, towards the posterior wall of the bladder, and where it is joined by the duct from the seminal vesicle to form the ejaculatory duct. So the ejaculatory duct will be formed by the joining of the duct coming from the seminal vesicle and the vas deferens. Okay, next we will talk about the ejaculatory ducts. And the ejaculatory ducts are two tubes about 2 centimeter long. If this is the right sided duct, then there will be a left sided duct as well. So the ejaculatory duct ducts are two tubes, and their length is approximately 2 centimeter, and as we have discussed, that each will be formed by the union of the duct from a seminal vesicle and a deferent duct. They will pass through the prostate gland, and they will join the prostatic urethra, that is basically one part of the male urethra that we will discuss in our next slide. So you can see that this ejaculatory duct here is passing through the prostate gland, and it will join with the prostatic urethra, and this will carry the seminal fluid and the spermatozoa to the urethra. As we know that the urethra is a common passageway for the ejaculation and for urine in a male, so definitely the ejaculation will contain the seminal fluid and the spermatozoa. So these will be ejaculated through the urethra. This is a common passageway. The walls of the ejaculatory ducts are composed of the same layer of tissues as the seminal vesicles. Okay, now we will talk about the prostate gland, and this is the prostate gland, and you can appreciate the other structures as well, and we have talked about all the structures earlier, so I hope that it will more easy for you to appreciate these structures. So the prostate gland, by its location, it lies in the pelvic cavity in front of the rectum. So definitely there will be the rectum behind, so we can say that it is lying in front of the rectum, and behind the symphysis pubis. So symphysis pubis, as we know, is a joint, a cartilaginous joint between the two pubic bones. So they will be interior to the prostate gland, and the rectum will be posterior to the prostate gland. Okay, so if we talk about its structure, then it has an outer fibrous covering that will enclose the glandular tissue and that will be wrapped in smooth muscle. The weight of the gland is about 8 grams in younger age, but it will progressively enlarge, and we can say that it hypertrophies with age, and it will cause the urinary incontinence, and the patient will keep saying that I feel the urgency, I go to the bathroom, I urinate, but still I feel the urgency. So the reason for that is the hypertrophied prostate that causes the pressure on the bladder. And this condition occurs at the age of 50 and above. Next, we will talk about the structure of penis, and before that we will talk about the parts of the urethra. You can see the three parts of the main urethra: the prostatic, membranous, and the penile or bulbous urethra. The male urethra, as we have discussed earlier, provides a common pathway for the flow of urine and semen, and its length is approximately 19 to 20 centimeters long, and it consists of three parts: the prostatic urethra that originates at the urethral orifice of the bladder, and it passes through the prostate gland that we have seen in the previous images, and you can see it here as well. This is the prostatic urethra, and it is originating at the urethral orifice of the bladder, and it passes through the prostate gland. This is the prostate gland. Next is this green one part, and this is the membranous, and this is the shortest part, and it extends from the prostate gland to the bulb of the penis. This is the bulb of the penis. The penile urethra lies within the corpus spongiosum of the penis, and it terminates at the external urethral orifice in the glans penis. This is the glans penis, and this is the external urethral orifice. So we can say that the penile urethra lies within the corpus spongiosum. This is the corpus spongiosum. This middle part is called the corpus spongiosum of the penis. So the the Nile or the bulbous urethra, as you can see, this one is highlighted with red color. This part is within the corpus spongiosum, or we can say that the penile urethra lies within the corpus spongiosum of the penis, and it terminates at the external urethral orifice in the glans penis. This is the glans penis, and you can see the penile urethra terminating at the external urethral orifice in the glans penis. There are two urethral sphincters. The internal sphincter is a ring of smooth muscle at the neck of the bladder above the prostate gland, and the external sphincter is a ring of skeletal muscle surrounding the membranous part. And now we will look at the structure of the penis, and you can see that the penis has a root. This is the root, this is the body or the shaft, and this is the glans. The shaft is the externally visible part, and it contains the erectile tissue and the smooth muscle, and this erectile tissue is supported by the fibrous tissue, and it is covered with the skin, and it has a very rich blood supply. The two lateral columns are called the corpora cavernosa. These two columns, the lateral columns, are called the corpus cavernosa or the corpora cavernosa. And the column between them that contains the urethra is called the corpus spongiosum. This one is the corpus spongiosum that is highlighted with the yellow color. This is the axial section, and in this you can see these two columns that we have called the corpus cavernosa or the corpora cavernosa, and between them you can see another column that contains the penile urethra, and we named it as the corpus spongiosum. Okay, so at its tip you can see it is expanded into a triangular shaped structure, and this is known as the glans penis. Arterial blood supply is supplied by the deep dorsal and the bulbar arteries of the penis, which are the branches from the internal pudendal arteries, and this is a very important MCQ as well. So just remember that the blood supply will be from the branches of the internal pudendal arteries, and these are the deep dorsal and the bulbar arteries of the penis. There is a series of veins drain blood to the internal pudendal and the internal iliac veins, and the nerve supply is also very important, that is supplied by the autonomic and somatic nerves. And the parasympathetic stimulation will lead to the filling of the spongy erectile tissue with the blood that will cause the arteriolar dilation and the venous constriction that will increase the blood flow into the penis, and it will obstruct the outflow, and the penis will therefore become engorged, and it will erect for the sexual intercourse. So I have written some very important MCQs as well that can be asked. Which branch of the internal iliac artery supplies the blood to the penis? And the right answer is the internal pudendal artery. We have just studied about it. Next question is, which anatomical space does the spermatocord travel through? And we know that the spermatocord travels through the inguinal canal. If we look at this image, then you can clearly see the spermatocord traveling through the inguinal canal. We have now know about it, that it will start from the inferior abdominal part, and then it will travel through the inguinal canal, and then it will end in the scrotum. So the answer is the inguinal canal. And the last MCQs is about the epithelial lining of the urethra, and this is also a very important question. The epithelial lining of the urethra is the stratified planar epithelium. So that's all for today, and if you have any question regarding this lecture, then you can ask. Thank you so much.